Good? Okay, so Carl got you to the point, when we talk about sort of the CPU, when we talk about memory, we talk about the disk, we sort of go through three stages. We talk about a little bit about the details of the hardware, so you guys, and we talk about some of the abstractions that the operating system creates in order to hide some of the unpleasant details of hardware, so you guys learned about threads and about how I switch back and forth between them. And then at some point, we get to talk about policy. So how the operating system is responsible for understand how threads get moved back and forth on the CPU, some of the mechanisms that underlie that, how the kernel gets control of the system. And today, we'll talk about how it uses that control today and tomorrow and Friday, how it uses that control to try to make the best use of the system resources when it has to choose which thread has to run. So this is something called thread scheduling. We'll sort of set the stage today by talking about some of the goals on interactive systems. So what do you guys expect your computer to do? What would be some of the things that you would notice if the scheduling that your computer was doing really broke down, really got bad? And then on Wednesday, we'll talk about some scheduling algorithms. And then on Friday, we'll do a case study of sort of a more modern scheduling algorithm, talk about that. All right. Three cheers for Carl. Let's give Carl a round of applause. You know, I don't think the right question is, was Carl awesome? The question is, how awesome was Carl, right? Because I can imagine that was fantastic. According to him, he has some of his own verbal tics to work on, just like me. So on that, I don't know how many times he said that, but I'll go back on the video and count. But yeah, I really appreciate that Carl lectured. Assignment 2 checkpoint. So Scott and I were, you know, the course staff were pretty happy with the numbers for assignment 2.1. How many people didn't submit assignment 2.1 but tried to submit assignment 2.1? OK, a couple of people, right? Yeah, I mean, I hope that it's at least got people moving, right? Even if you didn't manage to get the 20 points, maybe at least you understand what you're up against. So if you haven't got that far, then you really are behind at this point on the assignment. I know that's hard to believe. You know, in the assignments that we've given you at UB before, there's no way to be behind until like 2 hours before they're due, right? But you're actually behind. You have like under 3 weeks left to go. This week, as I suggested, I would focus on finishing the file system calls and getting to the point where you can pass the file-only test and some of the other tests that pass to that point, which would leave you a couple more weeks for doing the process-related system calls, which are actually quite a bit more difficult. There's more code to write. You know, the file system ones, as you guys are understanding, you're sort of connecting two interfaces. You're essentially writing, you know, code that's sort of connecting the system call interface with the lower-level VFS interface. And a lot of the code that's there is already written for you. When you get to the process-related stuff, that's not true. You know, you're writing those from scratch. Okay. Any questions on assignment 2, logistics, blah, blah, blah. But I mean, this is all going to work. This is how we're going to do things from here on out. There's really no changes to how you submit, how we grade things, blah, blah, blah. Next target is assignment 2 or 2.2. I think you can use both. And off we go. All right. Cool. All right, so I just want to just sort of a quick public service announcement today about how sort of people treat each other when you work in groups, when you're in a class together, when you're on the forum. So let me put it this way. There's like an exchange rate between being an asshole and being good at something. And that exchange rate is really high. Like, you have to be really, 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 really good at something to get away with just being a tiny, tiny little asshole from time to time, okay? So think about how you're gonna allocate your resources here, right? And you know, to some degree, I can confess, I performed this experiment, right? And it didn't work. So the point is that really what matters at the end of the day, what matters at the end of the day is, you know, did they come away with a good impression of you? Maybe the impression they came away from of you is that you can't do that particular thing. That's fine. That's an okay impression, that's a positive. It's a jerk, right? So just don't do that. It's not that hard. It is hard a little bit because, again, remember, you're overestimating how nice you are about things, right? So you need to round up a little bit there. All right, so just, you know, please keep this in mind as you guys work together, work with your partner, communicate on the forum and things like this. Trust me, like, you talk to people in tech, they don't care how talented you are. They will not hire you if you have some sort of problem getting along with people and the way you treat other people. They just don't want that. Nobody wants that. It's not fun. Okay. Questions from last week's material? Any lingering doubts I don't know what was covered because I wasn't here. Interrupts, threading, context switches, this all makes sense. Carl preached the truth. He brought wisdom. Okay, good. So I think where we left off is talking about threads and thread states. So the thread is this abstraction that we use to represent the state of the CPU. When I context switch a thread off the CPU, I need to save some information so that I can restore it later. When we think about threads, and this becomes important when we talk about thread scheduling, the threads in the system are in one of several states at any given point. What are some of the states that they can be in? What's an obvious state? Running. So what does that mean? It means a thread is actually executing on a core. Remember, thread can only be on one core at one time. A process can have multiple threads, so a process can actually be running on multiple cores at one time, but a thread is only running on one core at one time. So a thread can be running, executing instructions, you know, doing business. What else? Sleeping. So what does sleeping or waiting imply? There's an implication here. If I'm waiting or sleeping, what has to happen? Well, remember, if I'm not running, then I'm assuming I performed a context switch where I can get myself off the CPU. But what has to, like, so from a scheduling perspective, can I pick a thread that's sleeping and put it on a CPU and run it? Yes? No? Yes? No? I hear both. I like this. Confusion. Carl's not perfect. I thought maybe I'd just let Carl do the rest of the class. But clearly Carl has left some seeds of doubt. It's probably my fault in the slide, it's not his fault. Waiting. So can I take a thread that's waiting and just run it? Yeah. Right, so threads that are blocked or waiting are stuck. They cannot run. They cannot run until something else happens. What are some examples of that thing happening? A lock, right? So imagine I'm using a lock to defend a critical section. I cannot let a thread continue until it acquires the lock. If I do, then the critical section is broken. So the thread that is sleeping on that lock cannot run again until that condition changes. Yeah.
Could you try to run a waiting thread and it would just kind of halt?
No, usually I could, but that would invalidate something that I want to happen, yeah. Right? So for example, give me another example of what I could be waiting for. So if I'm waiting for a lock and I just jump in there and start executing, I'm inside a critical section probably with another thread, right? And that's the exact reason I created locks in the first place, was to avoid that. What else could I be waiting for?
Resources.
What's that?
Resources.
OK, yeah, so give me an example.
If you're waiting to print something.
Waiting to print something, that's awesome. I've never thought. Yeah, so what would happen if I was waiting to use a printer and I just jumped in and started printing? I have no idea, actually. But it probably wouldn't be good for the printer, right? Like garbled stuff would come out or whatever. Have you ever guys printed raw PostScript before? Every department has somebody who does that periodically. And there's like thousands of pages with like two characters on each line, you know? So, but more common for at an OS level, I might be waiting on like a disk read or write to finish. So I said, you know, remember syswrite, I've got a buffer, I want that printed. If I'm reading, I've got a buffer, I want that filled. I don't want to continue to execute until that's true, because if I start running, the buffer doesn't have the data in it that I want it. It's just got garbage. So threads that are blocked cannot run, right? Something else has to happen in order to free them. The other state that's interesting here is ready. So a thread that's ready can run, but it's not running. And so why do I end up with threads that are in the ready state? What has to happen before I get threads that are in the ready state? I mean, threads can block for all sorts of reasons. I/O, locks, you know, timers, all sorts of reasons. Why do I end up with threads in the ready state? What's that? Well, that's how I get them there, but what has to be true in order for a thread to be in there, to be threads in the ready state? There's a property of the system that has to hold. Yeah.
All cores are being
visible? You're close, right? Just because all cores are busy doesn't mean anything's in the ready state. I need one more thing to be true. I need another thread that's ready to run, right? So when the number of threads that can run is greater than the number of cores that are available, I'm going to end up with threads in the ready state. And so to some degree, the process of thread scheduling boils down to how do I move threads between the ready and run state so that the whole system makes as much progress as possible. All right, and we can think about some of the transitions here, right? So a thread goes from running to ready. So what happened here? Gave it away. Remember, it goes from running to ready. So it's running, and at some point it gets stopped, but it's still ready to run. So what had to happen here? Something that this was what we call descheduling. The kernel said, you've run for long enough, performed a context switch, that's the exact mechanism that I used to get it off of the CPU, and put it in the ready state, right? What about this, running to waiting? Now note that these are two completely different transitions, right? A thread can be running, and suddenly the OS says, you've had enough time, I'm pulling you off. Or it can go into the waiting state. What triggers this? Some sort of action that the thread itself took. I tried to do I/O, I tried to grab a lock, whatever. You know, so this is, you know, a thread performed some sort of blocking operation. It could have been a system call, it could have been some sort of synchronization primitive I was trying to use inside the kernel, whatever, right? And so the difference between these two is that in the top case, the kernel is doing this to the thread. The kernel says, you're done, I'm going to schedule something else. There's a few cases where a thread can ask to be rescheduled through something like yield, but that's rare. We use that, you guys have seen that in our test cases. We use that in our test cases to try to get a good mixture of threads at the beginning, but that's not a normal thing to do, right? Normally a thread wouldn't voluntarily say, oh, I don't need the CPU, somebody else should go ahead, right? Threads aren't like that, remember, they're male, they don't do that. All right, so running to waiting, a thread performed a blocking system call, so that's something that the thread itself would do, right? That would cause it to not be able to continue, it gets put on a queue somewhere, and off it goes. Waiting to ready. So a thread was waiting for something, and now it goes into the ready state. What does this imply? Whatever it was waiting for happened. I was waiting for I/O to complete, it's done. I was waiting to get a lock, I have it, whatever. And then finally, ready to running. This is the scheduling operation. So a thread was scheduled. Again, remember what I said before, scheduling is adjusting what threads are in the running state and what threads are in the ready state. And the way the operating system does that is it moves them back and forth as needed. What's the mechanism, just a little bit of a review from last week, how do I perform these transitions? How does the operating system get a chance to move a thread from the running to the ready state? I mean, I'm a thread, I'm running on the CPU, I'm happy, off I go, I'm not gonna yield, I don't wanna give up the CPU ever, I've got important digits of pi to compute. How does the kernel get control? How does the kernel get to run? How do I get to yank that thread off? Timer interrupts, right? So these top two things correspond with preemptive scheduling. It means that from time to time, as needed, the kernel's gonna preempt the thread that's running, move it off the CPU, and run something else. All right. Running to terminated, I can exit or hit a fail exception. So that's how the threads leave the system, right? And then if I wanted to be really accurate, you put fork on here or something like that, a way to create new threads. All right. Okay, so scheduling is the process of choosing what threads to run. So moving threads back and forth between the ready and the running queue. And you know, one thing that you might think is interesting is I have machines with more and more cores. This question is more interesting. There are some interesting features to multi-core scheduling that we're not going to talk about, but on some level, multi-cores make scheduling a little bit easier, right? Because on a single-core machine, if anything is working, I always have a problem. Because once I have two threads, I have a scheduling problem. How many threads do I need to have a scheduling problem on an eight-core machine?
Nine.
But it's even more than that. It's nine that are actually ready to run. Keep in mind, a lot of threads spend a lot of their time blocked waiting for network packets to arrive or for you to type a key or something like that. I mean, Bash spends most of its time waiting for your slow, fat fingers to type in keys, right? That's what it spends most of its time doing, just sitting there waiting for you. If you ever look at the CPU time of Bash, the amount of time it's actually been running is tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of the amount of time you've been using it, because most of the time it's sitting there waiting for your slow fingers, right? Especially those of you that can't type very well. So scheduling, you know, and so I need to have a scheduling problem on multi-core machines I may not always have, all right? And we're going to talk primarily about single core scheduling. There's some interesting features of multi-core scheduling. Maybe we'll get back to that at some point, particularly once you start to think about caches and locality and stuff like that. But you can think of the problem as simply, you can reduce the scheduling problem to single core scheduling, and it preserves most of the interesting features, that we want to talk about. All right. So why does the kernel have to perform scheduling? Like, why is this our problem? Yeah, I mean, you know, once we have more threads than we have CPUs, this is CPU multiplexing. And remember, this is the kernel's job. You guys talked last week about how the kernel gets this privileged role on the system. It runs first, you know, and it becomes the gatekeeper for how everything else gets access to the system. And so this is our responsibility. Along with that privilege of, you know, making these decisions comes the responsibility of trying to make them well. And, you know, bad scheduling can really reduce application performance. Yeah?
Would there be multiple levels of scheduling? Because if there is a single core, I have two processes running. It has to be time sliced into two processes have to be accommodated, and each process can contain multiple threads.
Mm-hmm.
So does it only perform the thread switching, or is it some sort of priority attached to? Because two processes have to run.
Yeah. Right.
So it can be of either.
Yeah. Process. Yeah, and I think the question has to do with multi-threaded processes and how do I accommodate those. I mean, on some level, what the kernel is scheduling are threads. So if a process creates a bunch of threads, those threads are being scheduled independently. Now, that's not entirely true. I mean, I have to think about fairness issues between multiple processes, and I also have to think about there are some consideration played in certain schedulers to the fact that two threads are from the same process, right? They might run better on a core that has better cache locality or other things like that, right?
But would there be a scenario where instead of scheduling threads, you schedule processes, and in that time, schedule threads of that each process?
You could do that, yeah. But on some level, remember, one of the reasons of having multi-threaded processes is I want to take advantage of this concurrency, right? I mean, the reason that a lot of new languages give you a lot of concurrency is because I want one process to use all of the cores, right? I mean, that's one of the cool things you can do with languages like Go, is I can very easily create single programs that make really good use of 8 cores, 16 cores, 32 cores, right? If all I'm doing is running one task from any process or one thread from any process, then I lose that, right? And again, on a high core count machine, if there's nothing else to do, I might as well let your process have all the cores, right? Yeah, it's a good question. But yeah, certainly multi-threaded processes complicate this a little bit further. All right. So going back to our thread state transitions, when do I have the chance to make scheduling decisions? There's a couple of points, right? And this is sort of good review. So when does the kernel get a chance to make a scheduling decision? What's that? Well, that's when I have to make them. But when in time do I actually have the chance to shuffle things around? When can I move threads between the ready and the running? What are some of the events that take place? Yeah, please. Yeah, what's an example of something that would generate an interrupt that would give me the chance to do this? So the timer interrupt that I set up to enable preemptive scheduling, absolutely. Like that gives me, that's, remember, what I do to make sure that I have a chance periodically to reschedule threads. But what else do threads do that give me a chance to do this? They do blocking system calls and other things. So anytime a thread makes a system call, it doesn't have to come out. You know, it can make the call. And that call might be like get PID. It might be something that doesn't have to block at all, but the kernel's like, aha, this is my opportunity, right? You're running in the kernel now, and if I want to, I can move you onto the ready queue and run something else, right? But certainly anytime you do anything that sleeps, when a thread does a blocking system call, I have to run something else. I've got nothing else to do. That thread ends up on a queue waiting for IO to come back, and the kernel has to choose something else to run. So that makes me make a scheduling decision. If I have a timer that goes off, that's a way to grab control from threads that aren't making system calls and may not give me that opportunity. What happens when there's nothing to do? This is something I've never covered before in the slides, but maybe it's not obvious. Anyone know? What's that? Well, yeah, hopefully. Right? There's like ghosts in the machine that get a chance to run. It's like, ooh, not SETI at home. It's built into your machine. It runs in the background all the time. yeah, there's usually like something called the idle thread or the idle task. I think on Sys161, that just consists of a bunch of no ops. On modern machines, if that goes on for long enough, the kernel may decide to turn cores off. It may say, I don't have enough work to do, so I'm going to power that core down, save some energy, particularly on battery powered devices. But yeah, it's usually some sort of meaningless little calculation you can find in every kernel that just kind of like sits there either doing nothing, or sometimes you fire a timer periodically so you can wake up again and see if there's anything else to do, but you basically just sort of go into some sleep state. Hopefully nothing happens at that point. All right. Okay, I'll set that. So, and what I just said, you know, I mean, in certain cases, there are places where, particularly in user space thread libraries, it's useful to call yield. But the modern kernels don't depend on threads calling yield and voluntarily giving up the CPU. So there are, on most systems, ways to say, you can, you know, I didn't do a system call, but hey, here's my chance. Here's your chance to deschedule me if you need to. All right. And then, you know, and some of this you guys already talked about. So we talked about the mechanisms of how we do scheduling. We do a context switch and we just move the thread around internally. So we need to keep track of what's going on. But this is all based on stuff that you guys talked about last week. Now, how we do this is what we're going to talk about today and on Wednesday, right? How do we choose which threads to run? All right. This is the first example of something that we're going to see repeatedly. Like I said before, I mean, we usually we start with the mechanisms in this class, and then we get to the point at which we're talking about policy. But one of the things that's really important to notice is it's usually a goal when building complex systems to try to separate the policy and the mechanism as much as possible. A well-designed system gives me mechanisms that allow me to build lots of interesting policies. What happens when these two get intermingled is there's something about the mechanism that biases the system, or maybe there's something that causes it to behave a certain way that's built into what I'm trying to do, and I can't make as intelligent decisions on top, right? Does this make sense? Have people talked about this before? Has anyone ever heard this before? Heard these two words in the same sentence? All right, so this is also connected a little bit with good interface design, which we've talked about in the past, right? A good interface tries to make sure that the mechanisms can change while the policies are described by the interface and not changing. This is a stupid slide, right? So these were examples of policies and mechanisms, right? So making decisions about which thread to run, that's a policy. The ability to move threads around is a mechanism, right? What about maintaining queues that have different threads in them? Is this an example of a policy or a mechanism? Who thinks it's a mechanism? Yeah, there's no scheduling policy described here. This is just bookkeeping. It's just making sure that I don't lose track of threads. I don't accidentally like forget that a thread existed and like it vanishes into the ether and never runs again, right? Because that would be bad. What about if I try to give preference to interactive tasks? It's a policy. And you can think about, giving preference to them involves performing context switches at the right time and moving threads between those queues in a certain way. About using timer interrupts to stop tasks as they're running. It's a mechanism. This allows, and on some level, this is an interesting mechanism because it gives me the ability to implement certain types of policies. If there was no way for me to stop like a runaway thread that started to compute pi or something like that, then the policies that I would implement in the scheduling would be different. What about choosing a thread to run at random? Policy or mechanism? Yeah, this is a scheduling policy. It may not be a very smart one, right? But it's still a policy about how I choose threads to run. All right. So let me try to emphasize how important CPU scheduling is. You guys may have never thought about this before, but in order to do pretty much anything on your machine, something has to run. It doesn't matter if it wants to send network packets, use the disk, draw to the screen, detect keystrokes, whatever it is. The application has to run on the CPU. Does that make sense? I mean, there's no like mystical, magical ways for a sleeping thread to be like, let's draw some pixels to the display. That's not what happens. Sometimes you can put things in a buffer and that happens later, but there's this process by which the CPU starts to gate every other resource on the system. So in order to do anything, I have to get to the CPU first. Now, frequently, all I'm doing is I'm getting to the CPU in order to tell some other component to do something, and then I'm going to end up on a waiting queue or whatever. But I still have to run, right? There's no way to kind of like There's no way to get around this. So the CPU ends up being sort of the top level gate to every other resource on the system. Now, like I said, it's common that what threads want to do is just use the CPU so that they can get to some other thing and then go to sleep. And that observation guides some of the scheduling policies we're going to talk about. Right? This idea that a lot of threads don't want to do lots of computation. They just want to use the CPUs so that they can, you know, write to the disk or, you know, take some data from the network and move it somewhere else. Right? But I still need to run. I wish we could do this experiment. I wish there was like a, I don't know, maybe if I ever work for Microsoft again, I'll convince them to put some like crappy scheduler mode on their computers, right? So you can see what really bad scheduling is like. Right? Because that would be fun, right? Like, see how slow your computer can feel, right? I mean, there's times when your computer already feels pretty slow, and it's trying to be smart. So imagine if it was really dumb. And, you know, and so intelligent scheduling effectively makes use of, you know, system resources. And it will make even a moderately powered system feel very fast and responsive. Whereas bad scheduling can make even a really powerful system feel laggy. And I have proof of this because I have like a 20-core Xeon system under my desk, and Ubuntu is terrible on it. It's like, you know, you hit keys and it's like, oh, there goes the screen, right? So there's no reason for that because I know that this is like a super powerful machine. It's just bad software somewhere, right? So trust me, if you want to come use my system sometime and get a sense of like what several thousand dollars worth of CPU will buy you in terms of poor interactive performance, go for it, right? But again, this is my proof because that machine should fly and it doesn't always. And like sometimes like even the browser windows slow down. I'm like, what is going on down there? Like, what are you doing? Maybe it has a virus, who knows? All right, I'm gonna focus our discussion today on interactive expectations for computers. We'll talk a little bit about servers along the way. But that's one big sort of gap here when we start talking about how we allocate resources between different types of machines. I think it's more interesting to talk about interactive performance because you guys experience it in a visceral way. Now, with the cloud and things like this, I mean, maybe you guys see some of this from time to time, but let's talk about sort of your expectations on machines. So what do you guys expect from your machine? Another way to address this question is, how do you notice that something's going wrong? Right, sometimes we don't understand our expectations until they're violated. So what's something that your computer will do that you find really annoying that makes it very hard to use? Yeah, Dan.
Usually something goes wrong when the fan starts spinning up at crazy speed when you don't expect it to.
All right, so like unexpected high CPU usage, right? But what is that typically accompanied by? Right, because on some level, okay, it's a little annoying if the fan is on, right? But what else is happening? Does that bother you inherently if your fan is running? Okay. We've got some curmudgeons over here. Just let the fan run. Sometimes the fan just wants to run, you know? It's like I just need to get going. I gotta loosen up a little bit. Yeah.
Usually when the fan starts kicking high like that, right around the time everything starts to slow down, it takes 3.5 hours to load a single program.
Yeah, so like, okay, startup delays, right? You double click on an application, it takes a long time to load. Okay. What else? What about as you're using an application, right? Yeah. Yeah, like this. Well, and that's usually buggy code, right? That's usually not the result of bad scheduling. But what's something that happens on these devices, you guys know? The mouse will stop working, or it's like a little laggy, you know? Like you move it, and it's like, oh, there we go, you know? And so it's like it becomes very hard. Does anyone? Sorry, I'm gonna just. Yeah, yeah, let's get there. But yeah, so anything where it's like it's hard to, you guys have gotten to a point where it's like hard to enter text because it's like a little bit laggy. Like you click somewhere and you think it's working, but then it doesn't, or you click again and then you get two clicks, you know. So my little story, does anyone shop at Wegmans here other than me? Okay, does anyone use those things in the produce area where you can put those things are terrible, right? Maybe it's just my store, but like you hit the key and it's like, wait, where am I? I'm still in a grocery store. Oh, right, okay, like I'm supposed to let you. You're sitting there like, what is going on? Like, and then of course, you know, I've hit the key 4 times by that, so it's like 4444, and that's like asparagus or something like that. It's like, no, that's not what I have, right? Those things are miserable. I don't know who made that, but that's like, if that's what you build when you go out in the world, like, don't do that, right? Don't be that person. Like, somebody's responsible for that code, okay? And it would be fun if we could get a hold of that code and make fun of it. Of course, we can't. We could just make fun of what became. But think about it, like, anyway, whatever. I'll stop here. But my smartphone's more interactive than that thing. I guarantee Wegmans paid like $1,000 per unit for those things. Yeah.
You don't think that the self-checkout thing is more annoying?
I haven't used those. I don't use the self-checkout. Right? No. They only, those are new.
Same, but bigger and more effective.
Yeah, those are new at my store. And you have to have under 15 items. I never do that. But yeah, but I hate those produce things, man. I'm miserable. But yes, so we expect responsiveness, right? When I click on something, I want either one of two things to happen. I want it to do something, do the thing I wanted, or at least I want some visual indication that something is happening. And you might start to notice this when you interact with your machine, all the different little visual cues that it gives you that something is happening, right? The button background changes color a little bit. Like, even if it takes a second for something else to happen, that's still indication to you that, okay, I heard you, I got it. You clicked on that thing, I'm working on it. You see waiting indicators, other things, right? So here's another expectation, right? So YouTube movies, I mean, how many people have ever experienced interruptions in their YouTube movie, right? I'm watching something, and then suddenly in the middle it stops. Like, that is, I don't know why, it's kind of irrational, but that's like one of the most irritating things that computers can do, right? It's like, that would, like, right in the middle of like a really funny joke, and it's like, buffering, you know? So that's not good. There are certain cases, and this is for certain types of behavior, where we expect computers to be able to continue to do something sort of reliably over a long period of time, okay? And then the last thing is this idea of being able to complete certain tasks. So, like compiling your code, right? Now that may be at the, if most of your machines are fast enough that a lot of compiles become like a, almost like a responsiveness thing. Like, is it done yet? It's been 2 milliseconds, right? But on older machines, it was like I fired up my compilation of the Linux kernel, and then I went away and I got coffee, and you know, I did some shopping, and I came back, and it was still going, right? But I actually do want that thing to finish, right? And whether it takes 10 minutes or 10 hours is kind of important to me, right? Does anyone do anything with their computer that falls into that category? Has anyone ever gotten to the point where like you're really praying for like a 2x speed up? Like a 2x speed up would really help me, right? Because it would mean like a week to 3 days. You guys got to find some cool stuff to do with your computers, right? Yeah, Ed.
The build for PhoneLab?
Yeah. So Ed builds Android platform, the Android platform for our PhoneLab phones, and that can take like, what, an hour?
Hour and a half.
Hour and a half, yeah. So imagine if I could get 10x out of that. It goes from being 90 minutes to 9 minutes, right? Like that introduces a new development cycle into my life, right? Okay, so responsiveness. So this is probably, I would argue, one of the core components of a good interactive experience, right? You don't even have to finish the thing that I ask you to do. I just need to know that we're on the same page, right? If I'm typing, if I'm trying to click on stuff, if I'm scrolling down a page, right? I mean, the ability of the machine to respond to these type of events is really critical, right? A lot of what we do with our computers consists of these type of interactions, to some degree, right? Once you guys find the YouTube video that you want to watch, then it's more like a TV. But getting there and doing other things online, I mean, that's kind of what distinguishes computers from television, right? And again, it might not finish right away, but the idea that my input has been accepted and the computer is working on it, and I understand that, is really critical. So examples of responsive tasks, I mean, you guys already mentioned a couple of these. Clicking on stuff, right? When you click on a link in a website, right? You know, it may take a minute to load that new web page, but there's a series of signals that the web browser is sending me that this is what's happening, right? So I can avoid clicking on the same place a couple of times. Same thing with editing, you know, moving around in an editor, typing, these types of things. You might think this is kind of basic, but if you think about all the work that your editor has to do syntax highlighting and layout and all sorts of things, this can actually be a little bit of an issue. Not for me, I use Vim, right, which does none of those things. But if you use like these fancy new editors, actually I started trying to use Atom recently, I was like, this is a little laggy. Like, that's not good, I don't like that. Anyway, but yeah, if you use like a very, very dumb editor, it doesn't do any things, but modern editors do. And so there's a fair amount of work that they're trying to do behind the scenes. Same thing with chatting, text messages, Hangouts, stuff like that, right? I mean, any delay that you introduce into this process is problematic, right? So what's the sort of scheduling goal that comes out of this? when you guys input data, when you guys click, touch, tap, whatever it is, the computer should jump to, right? Something should happen. And there's a very, very sort of short timer that goes off in your brain when you click on something where you're starting to expect something else to happen. And when that timer goes off, or goes off 10 times in a row when I'm at Wegmans, right, like you start to get very frustrated. All right. Continuity. So when you ask a computer to do something and continue doing that thing over a long period of time, now this isn't a race, okay? That's the difference between this and the next task. You don't want to watch the YouTube video as fast as possible, right? You're not asking your computer, like, download it and show it to me as fast as you can, right? You're saying, for the next half an hour, I want you to, at intervals, continue to fill the frame buffer and deliver, you know, smooth video or smooth audio if you're using things like Spotify. And there's some active waiting involved here, right? It's not the same thing as click, where it depends on your input. But you guys notice when this breaks down, right? When the Spotify feed goes out, or it starts to get a little jumpy, or when the YouTube video starts buffering, or whatever, or when there's a little bit of jitter in it. I mean, we're pretty sensitive to this, so we'll notice this. Blinking cursors. Does anyone still use a blinking cursor? No one? Of course you do. Everyone does. Okay, good. There's this whole, if you Google blinking cursor, you could find this whole web page about how blinking cursors are like the equivalent of Chinese water torture. So maybe they finally got rid of them in most places. I think Ubuntu for a while still came with blinking cursors, and you had to like issue these magic spells to get it to stop. But blinking cursors, I mean, have you guys ever looked at your machine and seen the cursor blinking get a little wanky? You know, it's like, you know, CPU usage goes up, you know. Anyway, I mean, maybe that was just me. Maybe there was something else going on when I was looking at the cursor. anyway, so like playing music, playing movies, you know, again, you know, little stupid web animations, right? Ads that run on the side of websites. I mean, these are things that we expect there to be the smoothness of purpose. Now, again, these are not necessarily loading the machine down in every minute, but there's this expectation that I can schedule little bits of work periodically over a long period of time, and make sure that certain invariants are met. All right. The last thing here is this idea of completion. So the idea that I'm going to be able to give the computer some work to do, and the work's going to get done eventually. Now, you may not be even aware of this happening. You know, a lot of the things that the computers that we use are doing passively are not necessarily things that we're even cognizant of. You may notice when they stop happening. If they don't happen for a while, right? Now, like I said, I mean, these may not be things that you're starting, but these are the things that the computer is doing periodically. Anyone give me some examples of these? Like a long-running background task. Something that should finish, that the operation of the computer is predicated on it finishing, but you may not really realize this happened. Yeah. Yeah, okay, that's fair. Windows software updates, right? I mean, like, those usually notice because there's 82 pop-ups that are generated and warnings and stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, if your computer stops getting Windows updates for a while, there's going to be like angry red messages flashing everywhere, right? And eventually Chinese hackers or Russian hackers or hackers from somewhere are going to have control of your machine. So, okay, Windows updates, what else? What's that? Legal torrenting. I like that. I mean, illegal torrenting also falls into that category. I'm just going to point that out. But I like that. I like legal torrenting. Torrenting of which I only perform the legal variety. Yes, I think. Right. Yeah. No, that's a great point. Right. And here's the thing about torrenting. I mean, torrents, to some degree, the existence of the torrent ecosystem relies on people not noticing that they finish. Right. Because you're supposed to not notice, and then you're going to seed for like 30 years until the FBI shows up, right? Like, that's how torrenting works. System backups, does anyone back up their system? Okay, well, anyway. Okay, let's put it this way, restoring your system without a backup, could that you'll notice, right? Indexing files, this is one of those things, you guys don't even, does anyone use Spotlight or the Windows? Does Windows still have like a dog that comes up to help with things, or is that? See, you guys are so young, you don't even remember that. Come on. It's like a woof, woof, help me find things. It's like a The thing I never figured out is dogs are not good at looking for things. Dogs are good at, like, fetching things. I have a dog, so I know. I have firsthand knowledge. I like gnawing on bones. But why they thought a dog was, like, good, oh, I'll go look for your files. It's like, no, it's not. It's going to go, like, eat some cat poop and get sick, right? That's what a dog's going to do. It's not going to help you find files. But anyway, I mean, does Windows still has that, right? Like a find files thing? Like, the way these things work is they build indexes constantly, right? Spotlight or whatever the Mac thing is. I mean, it doesn't actually go look at your files every time you type a search query. That'd be way too slow. That'd be like Google being like, oh, you entered something into my search engine. Oh, okay, well now let me run my web search indexing and find all the, no, that's not how it works. I mean, it's all done beforehand. So yeah, in file indexing, antivirus software falls in this category. You know, it's running, it's doing things. You know, you might notice if it stops, but you don't notice it's happening. Okay. So a lot of applications, you know, on some level build multiple of these expectations in. So music player is a great example, or no one uses music players anymore. This is all just web browsers, right? So, but imagine a music player page loaded into your web browser. I hit click. What's a click type expectation for a music player? What's a place where I want it to do something based on my input? Yeah, play, stop. You know, imagine if it hit stop and it was like, I'll cue that later. Right, you know, like yeah, some song blare. I'm in here blaring a song, and the mad guy from geology comes in. It's like, I'll get to that later. Like once I'm done with my file index, I know. Yeah, so responsive, you know, change tracks. What about like a continuous sort of thing? That's obvious, right? I mean, playing the track itself. That involves a series of actions that have to be continued over a period of time. Updating album artwork, building indexes of my music collection, stuff like that. All these are all sort of like long-running tasks that get done in the background. Web browsers are obvious, you know, this sort of thing. All right. Now, the thing that makes scheduling fun, okay, the fundamental core tension between scheduling, particularly on interactive systems, is balancing two goals. The one is the ability to respond to new things, and the second is the ability to get things done and make best use of system resources in order to accomplish a lot of things at once. So if you do optimal resource allocation, it's very difficult to meet deadlines, because meeting deadlines requires that the system constantly be ready to drop everything and do whatever sort of weird new thing that you told it to do. So imagine your system is constantly like, okay, I'm going to plan for the next 10 minutes. Like, here's how I'm going to lay out the CPU. Here's how I'm going to lay out disk. Here's what I'm going to do with the network. This is awesome. I know exactly what's going on. Oh, no, we switched applications, right? Like, and you're doing this all the time, right? I mean, you're constantly, like, you are the biggest scheduling problem that the computer faces, because you keep doing things that it didn't expect. It's like, oh, man, why is he going to that website, right? I was just on that other website. So, I mean, you know, your unpredictability is something that the system is constantly trying to keep up with. You know, and responsiveness has these unpredictable deadlines, whereas continuity has these predictable deadlines. But again, your unpredictability can be constantly changing the mix of system resources and causing the system to focus on new things, right? I mean, switching pages in a web browser is a mild version of this, right? The extreme version is, like, you've been using Chrome and suddenly you launch Photoshop. It's like, oh my gosh, what just happened, right? I mean, those are totally different things, right? So the tension between these is what makes this interesting, right? And it's what motivates some of the scheduling algorithms we talked about. Now, you know, on interactive facing systems, the preference, now again, this is where the goals of servers and user-facing systems diverge slightly. This idea that on a user-facing system, deadlines typically win, right? You guys are sensitive to these things like interactivity. You're sensitive to things like rebuffering events and jitter on continuous audio or video or things like that. You're not as sensitive to knowing exactly when the file index that the system ran in the background finished. It's like, no one cares, right? Do it at night, you know, whatever. I mean, as long as it gets done periodically. Some of the stuff you guys aren't even aware of is going on in the first place, right? You know, no one, and the other thing that you guys don't care about is how well the system is using the resources it has, right? Like, you don't care if the system is using all its RAM. That means nothing to you, right? Has anyone ever noticed that the, like, Do you guys measure this? Does anyone care? Okay, I've got two hands up, right? Yeah. No, the system should use all its RAM, but I don't want it to use its RAM at the price of not paying attention to me, right? Like, you're supposed to use the RAM in service of this goal. To be honest, if my system can do all this with one stick of RAM, I don't care. Like, don't tell me, because I bought the other seven, right? But yeah, I mean, to the degree that the system can do, meet its deadlines and do the things I'm asking in a responsive way, whether or not it's using its resources is totally irrelevant. And you guys don't care. You don't track this, you know. And here's the fundamental difference, right? And here's what makes this fun, which is that your time, you know, my I was just talking with my dad the other day, and he's convinced that, like, robots are going to take over all of your jobs, okay? He's like, I'm really glad I'm retired, because he's reading some scary book about robots. And, you know, and okay, fair enough. I mean, computers are really powerful. That's a good thing to think about when you make life choices. Like, if you can do a job that can be easily replaced by a computer, I would probably find a new career, okay? But right now, your time is still way more valuable than your computer's. You know, so when your computer is wasting your time, that's when you get frustrated, right? When you're trying to do something that you think should take just a few seconds, like, I just want to send this text message, and it's like Hangouts is loading. What is going on, right? Just do what I want. The wasting of computer time, let's put it this way, there is a lot of computer time out there to waste, right? If you want to waste some computer time, computers have time to waste, right? All these phones that you guys are using, they sit there at night, plugged in for 8 hours, doing nothing, right? I mean, if you can figure out how to get them to cure cancer in that time, please do that, right? Because they've got cores to kill. Like, Google is, like, desperately trying to give away CPU cycles because they've got so many machines in their data centers to handle diurnal fluctuations. At night, they're not doing anything, right? Again, if you have an algorithm to solve cancer and you need 10,000 machines, we will find those machines for you. It is not hard, okay? There's a lot of power out there in the world, and it doesn't matter if a little bit's wasted. A lot of it's wasted, right? Software is terrible, okay? Software wastes a lot of cycles, but it doesn't matter because there's a lot of cycles to waste. Okay, so are we almost done? I think we're almost done. Before we finish up today, let's go through some scheduling goals, right? So this comes back to our expectations. How well does it meet deadlines? Both predictable deadlines, the deadlines that, you know, I can imagine in the future because I know periodically I have to wake up to fill the audio buffer, and unpredictable deadlines, deadlines that are created by your stupid fingers touching things, right? Or moving mouses around, or talking to your computers. I guess people do that now, not me. But how completely does the system allocate resources? Again, when I have really beefy stuff to do, I want to make use of all the resources in the machine. And on human-facing systems, deadlines win. On servers, not always, right? But, you know, bring this into the cloud era, right? So why are cloud servers now potentially a lot more interested in deadlines than they used to be? There's actually a fair amount of deadline attention now being paid in big data centers. Why?
Because you might be using them for your day-to-day tasks.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of applications and websites that are built based on cloud backends, right? So that cloud API call, that's in your interactive loop, right? When you guys use Discourse, like, the way Discourse works is it loads a web application into your browser, and then it's making API calls to the back end. So that thing may think it's a server, but when you click new post, again, that latency is now inside of your brain, right? It's not hidden back away in some dark room, right? You're waiting for a cloud server, right? And understanding how that latency fits in to the other forms of latency on the device is actually something that people are still working really hard on. All right, so we're not going to talk about real-time scheduling. Any questions about this? So on Wednesday, we will talk about some simple schedulers. We'll talk about some ways to evaluate their performance. And then we'll talk about some slightly more sophisticated schedulers. And on Friday, we will talk about obscene scheduling.